Hi, Apaar. Congratulations on the 730. How does it feel?
Hi, Dhananjay. Thank you for taking our time for this. It feels good, great, honestly. It's been some time, so that feeling is something, but I'm still happy and satisfied with how the journey culminated. So it's been good.
Speaking of journeys, take me through yours, right? So you've been through the offline approach in 2016 to, when you came on board with us. So what has your experience been like? And contrast both.
I think there were many benefits, but the few that really benefited me out of the online course was that, first of all, it was a self-paced approach. When I was preparing in 2016, I think I was still in college, so I had all the time in the world to attend classes on weekdays or weekends. But I think the world changes drastically once you're employed and you can't find that sort of a time out of your schedule. So the convenience of having to find an hour any day and then you know what to do is extremely essential, I think, for anyone who's working and planning to give GMAT. That's mostly the case with GMAT. One of the other important, I think this was one of the most beneficial things for me with e-GMAT, was that everything was structured. Otherwise, for any entrance, I think at least 2 to 3 weeks are spent on understanding what to do, from where to do, and how to start, where to end. I think those questions are automatically handled once you are at e-GMAT, because the structure to everything, be it verbal or quant, especially for verbal, for me, it had a structure with what topics to cover, which rules to follow. And with time, you get an idea that it'll take this much time and I've already spent this much time. So everything looks a little more in place rather than having to refer 10 books and then figuring out what to do from where. And the personal attention. The most skeptical I was about the online course was personal attention, because I think we are in the habit of having a teacher who's tutoring us. And that was one of the things that I asked one of my friends also, who had enrolled for eGMAT, that what if I have doubts one day and there's no one to help me? But kudos to that. Again, be it quant again or be it verbal, the response time was as quick can be. I think I never waited more than a day for the responses to come in. Also, they were continuous. Even if I didn't understand it in one go, there was no restriction that, okay, you've not understood, so now we leave it. There was constant conversation on that end, which was really helpful. And I'm sure some doubts would have been very basic and would have been repeated. And a lot of those doubts get answered in the section. I
Forums.
don't know what it's called. Yeah, in the forums. Yeah. In the forum section, a lot of them already get answered. So that section itself is pretty informative, in case, especially for quant. A lot of people have the same questions that they're asking. So I think that those three, four things really stuck out for me when I prepped with e-GMAT.
Perfect. So when you came on board, you took a mock and you got around 34th percentile on critical reasoning, right? And by the time that you actually gave the test or were giving mocks, your CR was at the 92nd or 93rd percentile. And of course, you took e-GMAT for verbal. But take me through how and what are the things that you worked on? What was your study plan for CR to improve from the 34th to the 92nd percentile?
I think one of the basic things was that, one, when I started preparing, I thought CR is an English section. I'll have to understand language options, and that is how it works. I think it was through e-GMAT and the way they take you through the course that you understand it goes beyond English. There's logic to it. There are tips and tricks to it, which I had never thought of that way. Because when you look at a question, it looks like a reading comprehension question. But if you delve deeper into it, it's not exactly that. So I think those tips and tricks are very helpful. Again, they are presented in a very orderly fashion. That's obviously there. Plus, when you go through the questions that are already provided by e-GMAT and the detailed explanations that are there, after a point you start making sense of how this works. Then there are practice questions. Then you're obviously, I'm asking doubts all the time. And slowly and steadily you start developing that. Since mocks are helpful, I used to give Scholaranium mocks where there are only 15 CR questions in the allotted time. I reduced that time over a course of my preparation, but I initially started with, say, giving 3 minutes per question. So in a test environment, when you're doing only critical reasoning, since that was my weak point, you slowly start making sense of how it is working. What words to notice? How can you eliminate options instead of having to go through all of them? That is one thing that is taught pretty well in e-GMAT, that don't look for the right option, eliminate the wrong ones, and whatever you left with becomes right. I think that's a very different and useful approach, especially for CR and RC. It helps.
Yeah. Got it. So I think you took a ton of ability quizzes, those time mocks that you were talking about, and you of course did really well on them. But you've also gone through the entire course end to end, even as a person who is fairly good at sentence correction and reading comprehension. What were your key learnings from the other parts of the course?
For sentence correction, one of the things that scared me initially was the amount of rules that are there. And especially for people like us who are not really rule bound in English, I used to rely on my sense of hearing. If it's sounding right, it must be right. If I speak it that way, it must be right. But when you study proper English, you realize that's not the case. So I think, but the way the course has been presented, it never looks overwhelming. It always feels that it'll happen instead of having a set of rules, that there are a lot of books that are available for GMAT, which just list rules, like idioms also are listed, and those lists run into 2, 3, 4 pages. Just going through that list is a daunting task, but when it's presented in the form of lectures, which are timed, say, 10 minutes, 12 minutes, 15 minutes, everything suddenly starts seeming doable. I think the first and foremost part of it is that nothing seems daunting. And obviously, then there's practice involved. When you have so many questions at your disposal and there are doubts that can be cleared over and over again, so you make sets and you practice, then there's also a functionality where you can segregate questions, say, easy, medium, or hard. I think that comes really... That really works to, at least to my advantage, because after a point, you know that easy questions I'm okay with, hard are ones that I'm getting stuck with. So you only practice hard questions. Plus you slowly get used to the timing factor also by giving so many tests. I think the concern for time reduces. You understand that this is my sweet spot. I take around 1.5 to 2 minutes for CR, but probably I can save time on RC. I think that sense slowly starts developing as and when you give more and more of these Scholaranium tests.
Got it. And it's more about what you take away from these tests as well to kind of reduce your timing, because yeah. It's very nuanced, right? I mean, you need to understand what works for you and what doesn't, and where to reduce time.
That analysis needs to happen at your end after a point. That's true.
Got it. So once you had done the course, you had taken these custom quizzes, the ability quizzes that you spoke about, you started, I think you did a little bit of the quant course as well. I think you did a little bit of the number properties and then the entire geometry course as well. As a guy who's sitting at, you know, already a Q50, you know, what are the values of that course that kind of work for you? And you're an engineer too. So what are the things that you took away from the course?
I think, again, first of all, there's a structure to the course. Like, I've studied maths, obviously, but that was a long time ago. So my knowledge was all here and there. I know I can do it, but probably I'm just taking 3 minutes for a question that can be done in a minute. I didn't have an approach in place. So why I took some specific topics for quant was because I realized that these questions are getting stuck again and again, either because of time or because of accuracy, because I don't have a method in mind. I just have the confidence that yes, I can solve it. So I think GMAT, e-GMAT, that way helps to put a method to the madness when it comes to quant for me. And I think a revision of sorts of what important tips and tricks can be used. I think you also get familiar with the kind of questions that are asked, because what math you studied and what is being asked are two completely different things. So I think to go through the course to understand that, okay, these are the topics that are commonly tested, it helps put your brain at the right place and to look for the right things while you're solving questions. I think that was helpful, yeah.
So for a person who's already at a certain level, if you kind of want to improve on your timing, your accuracy and hard questions, I mean, this is the perfect course for you, the Quant 2.0 course pretty much. And you would have remembered that it has diagnostic quizzes, right? You take those and the course kind of tells you, okay, just do this. So I think that also really, really helps reduce time. So you started taking mocks and you did well on a few mocks. You got 730, 740, 750. What were your takeaways and learnings from these mocks, and how did you implement them on the exam then?
I think multiple takeaways. First of all, when the score starts improving, first benefit is you get a little confident that I'm ready for the D-Day, rather than having a score of, so you can see that whatever prep I've been putting in for that time, it's having an impact. When you started at 680, now you're 730, 740. So you feel that you're on the right path. I think that was one of the first things that I took out of them. Then again, there's a detailed analysis that comes in. I think, again, a superb job where you define, I think if you take any section, say verbal, it's broken into four slots, and then you have an analysis that in the first slot, these many easy, medium, and hard questions were cracked by you, and how that graph progresses through the four sections, how much time you took for each question. So like there are instances, especially in quant, this used to happen where I've been on a question for 5 minutes and gotten it wrong. And then in the end, I'm just somehow running through questions in 30 seconds and questions that I could have solved, but obviously they're not right because they had only 30 seconds. It's happened with verbal also on sentence correction. I got stuck with the rule and then I'm thinking over it. And these are things you can't realize while you are giving the exam. It's only when you have done with it in the cool head, then you realize that, oh, I gave it so much time. So I think timing and the sense of improvement, I think, were two great takeaways. And obviously that stress of that this is the performance that I've been preparing for the 2 months, I think eases off the pressure for the last day that, yes, I've done this 6 times before. It's not a big task. I know how this happens rather than just being in the field and not being aware of how it is done.
Yeah. And you didn't take a lot of mocks as well. I think you just took a limited number of mocks. What is your opinion of, you know, the Sigma X mock versus the real exam? How true of an indicator is it of your ability?
I think it's true enough. I think higher chances that if your score on the real GMAT would be higher than Sigma X, in my opinion, because they are a little tougher, if I may put it that way, as compared to GMAT. GMAT tends to be a little easier, or probably it's the practice that has helped, but GMAT tends to be a little easier than what these tests are. And I think that's helpful. Rather than having an easy mock and a tough paper, I think it's always better to have a tough mock and an easy paper. I think it's pretty indicative. I think one of the challenges with GMAT is that it's adaptive. So if you keep on answering questions, it starts getting tough. Mm-hmm. And after a point, this used to happen with me. I used to judge that if the questions are coming easy, that means I've answered the previous ones wrong. So with those mocks, you get an idea that judgment should be left up to the examiner, and all your job is to answer them. I think all of those things come in, and it's pretty indicative, I would say. Like as indicative as it should be.
So I think that's a classic mistake that you mentioned. You know, a lot of people do this, that, okay, I got an easy question. Now I must have messed up my paper because that's why I'm getting an easy question. And the beauty is that when I gave my GMAT and I scored, you know, perfect on quant, I got these really easy questions towards the end. And I was like, I have thoroughly messed it up. And this was like X plus Y is equal to 6. And, you know, Y plus something is equal to 7. Right. Find Y. You know, that's, you're like, what? And eventually, I mean, what happens is there's a ton of experimental questions too. And my thought process was that, I mean, if I'm mucked up, it's great. I mean, this is an easy question. I can solve it. So let's just go ahead and do it. So yeah, I think that's a big learning as well to take away. Again, it was really nice to talk to you about any parting words for anyone taking the test that you would like to share with, you know, with context to your experience.
I'd just like to say that it becomes fairly easy if you have the right way to prepare for it. I don't think it's one of those exams which needs a lot of heart and mind into it. It's fairly structured. I think it's not a paper that comes out of the blue and then you're stuck in the middle. So I think if you have the right way to prepare, which e-GMAT provides you with, and you can just go through it, take your time with it. I don't think you need to rush through anything. It happens pretty smoothly. It's a smooth journey as compared to the other tougher entrances, if I may say so.
a lot of people find GMAT pretty hard too. But yeah, I think the structure part is very important because it is a test for B school, right? So you need to be strategic about it. And I think that's what we usually teach more than just telling everybody how to solve questions and give them formulae. So again, very, very happy to be talking to you today. And thank you so much. All the best for your future endeavors.
Thank you. Thanks a lot.